Hey guys, I am Vishal and I welcome you all to this session by Eureka. Today I'm going to give you an overview of yet another interesting topic, and today's topic of discussion is VMware. Now, as we move further with this topic, we are going to understand quite a few nitty-gritties of this particular topic from a beginner's perspective and also for someone who wants to understand and use VMware to a greater extent. So let's not waste any time and start by taking a look at today's agenda first. First and foremost, I would be talking about what VMware exactly is. Then I would discuss virtualization, which is very core to VMware. We would be understanding what virtualization is, why it is needed, and what are its types. Then I would also talk about another important topic, that is hypervisor and its types. Finally, I would finish things off with a demo part where I would be talking about all these topics. So let's not waste any time and quickly get started then. Okay, one more important point. When we discuss VMware, I would be talking about just the basics and I would quickly switch to virtualization. Why so? Because virtualization is something that you need to understand. Once you understand that, then you would be in a much better state to understand VMware. So this session mostly focuses on virtualization. As we move further and have more sessions, I would be talking about VMware in detail, like what VMware is, what are its components, and how to use those components and all those things. So let's quickly get started then. So when we talk about VMware, it is something that provides you with various cloud computing and software virtualizations. As far as VMware goes, it lets you do that. Now, it uses various softwares or programs to let you do this. And there are quite a few types of virtualizations as well. That is, you can have it on bare metal or you can have it at an operating system level. So let us try to understand what virtualization is. And all these terms which I just mentioned would make a lot more sense to you people. Well, to understand this, we need to understand a situation that existed before virtualization. We all know of a situation where we have a particular operating system running on a particular system and you run applications on it. Now, when we talk about it from a business perspective, what happens is you have a huge amount of infrastructure or maybe a number of servers connected together, quite a few applications running on top of it. Now, if you think about a monolithic architecture or architectures that existed prior to virtualization, what happened was we had a server and an operating system on top of it. And on that, we would run various applications. Now, there are two possibilities in this. One, you are using only 10% of this particular server or the capacity that you have. Say, for example, my application requires only this much computation space and this much amount of total storage size or whatever it is. Now, in that case, what happens is the remaining size that is allocated to a particular server and the compute capacity that you have, it goes waste because your application isn't using it to the full capacity or that is actually not required to be used. So the remaining space is total waste and it is not being used. So can we use or utilize this space better? Yes, we can do that by using virtualization. Now there is one more scenario which you need to understand. Now at times what happens is I have different types of applications which I want to use and those perform differently on different operating systems. Now in this case, if I have one particular server and one particular operating system on top of it, now I would be constrained to using those things only or that architecture only. So again, I'm tied to a particular architecture and I cannot experiment a little more. If I have to go ahead and use another operating system, then I'm forced to have another server and another operating system where I can run that application again. So yes, these are the problems that we face normally when we do not have virtualization. What virtualization does is it lets you have maybe a single server and on top of that, you can have multiple operating systems. Apart from that, there are quite a few other types of virtualizations as well. So by using virtualization, you can actually eliminate this problem of resource management and all those things. So let us try to discuss virtualization a little more and try to understand these points as in what happens exactly. So what does the definition has to say exactly? Well, when we talk about a particular type of virtualization, what happens is you have a particular machine or a particular resource that gets replicated or virtualized into a particular system or maybe even an operating system which you want to go ahead and use. So what is happening in the background is your so-called infrastructure, it is dividing the resources into such a way that it can be used by multiple people or can be used by a single person in multiple ways. So yes, as we move further and understand different types of virtualizations, you would understand this term a little more, but this is the gist as in virtualization is nothing but an ability to create a virtual version of a particular device, whether it's a server, a storage device, or even a network. Now, what happens is when virtualization does happen, whether it's the devices, applications, or human users, they're able to interact with this virtual resource as if it was a real resource, and they do not know what is happening in the background. Now, when we talk about virtualization, it can be as simple as partitioning your hard drive. Yes, that is also a type of virtualization. And it can be as complicated as maybe having application server virtualization and all those things. So what are these types of virtualizations and what do they exactly do? Well, as we all know that computing is something that is being used a lot, we have quite a few types of virtualizations that we deal with these days. And most of you might already be using these virtualizations. You're just not aware about it, as in what are these and how are they used exactly. So let us try to understand those one by one. And all the terms which I discussed in the past, now all of those would make a lot more sense to you as we discuss this particular slide. Now we have something called as virtualization at the operating system level. What happens here is this is something which is used in the most common way, or this is something that is used very widely. So what happens here exactly is we have a particular hardware or an infrastructure, and top of that, we run multiple operating systems. Now, why do we do that? Say, for example, I have a particular business and I have certain applications that I want to run on Mac OS, Windows OS, and even on Linux. So in that case, instead of having three different systems, what I can do is I can have a single system and run these three operating systems individually. So it is helping me save resources and also money. Then you have something called as application server virtualization. What happens here exactly is it is used for load balancing. That means suppose I have a number of applications and a number of servers. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and split those servers amongst these applications and these applications amongst these servers depending upon the need. So yeah, it's a vice versa kind of a thing. It helps me in preventing overloading of a particular server, and it also helps me from stopping an underperformance of a particular application as well. Then you have something called as application virtualization. It is a little different from application server virtualization. People normally confuse these two types of virtualizations. What happens in application virtualization is you have this feel of you running your particular operating system on your remote device, but that is what is not happening. It is actually running on some server which is based somewhere else, and you get this feel that it is happening on your system. This kind of virtualization is called as your application virtualization. Then you have something called as administrative virtualization. This is something for data centers basically. That is why not many people know about it. Basically, what happens here is, suppose we have various groups that work together and you need to exchange resources or give access to people to particular resources like read, write, and all those things. In administrative virtualization, what you do is you virtualize different atmospheres for different people or different groups to deal with. And accordingly, you can set in all the access rights and all those things. Now, this kind of virtualization is something you called as administrative virtualization. Then you also have something called as network virtualization. It is very basic and commonly used kind of virtualization. Here, virtualization happens at a level where you actually virtualize your IPs, not IPs, but the way you monitor and handle all those IPs and all those things, and giving network accesses and all those things. Now, this kind of virtualization is called as network virtualization. You also have something called as hardware virtualization. This is again something that is very common and used by quite a few people. What happens here is your actual hardware is virtualized. Now, this is similar to your operating system virtualization. Now, in fact, operating system virtualization and hardware virtualization is something that go hand in hand. And hardware virtualization happens so that you can go ahead and virtualize your operating system as well. Here, what you do is you basically have chunks of servers that are actually divided, and you can run different applications, or you can actually dedicate different chunks for different kind of applications to run on them, or not exactly applications. I would say these chunks are divided in such a way that they can perform specific tasks. This helps in faster computation actually. Here you have something called as storage virtualization monitors or management tools, which let you manage this virtualization. Your storage is basically divided into certain parts and data is stored on these storage devices. And then your so-called monitor manages all these devices, and it brings about virtualization and distribution of all the loads and resources that are moving around on these so-called storages. And your storages are actually not aware about what is happening, as in where is the data coming from and where is it going exactly. It is not aware as in where the data is exactly stored. It is the job of the monitor to take care of all these things. That is why there is this hidden part or a virtualization which happens here. You can think of it as worker bees, which perform their task tirelessly, but they are not aware about the know-hows. They're only aware about what task they're performing. That's it. So these were different types of virtualizations, and this is what virtualization is. It is replicating a number of different kinds of resources or your so-called operating systems or your architectures basically into more manageable or more handleable kind of environments. So let us move further and try to understand what a hypervisor is exactly. Now it is nothing but a virtual machine monitor. Now what it is exactly? We just discussed something called as virtualization or virtualization technique. Now how do we bring about this virtualization? To do that, we have something called as hypervisors. And as far as VMware goes, it provides you with both kinds of hypervisors, that is type 1 and type 2. But before we understand what type 1 and type 2 hypervisors are, let's try to understand hypervisor a little more. Now, for me to have, let's stick to the operating system level virtualization to understand this particular topic. To give you a simple example, I have a system with me. I can actually boot my system and have two different operating systems, but that can be a tedious task at times. But instead, what I do is I instead go ahead and I use my operating system and I use a particular tool that let me use some other OS on my system with the existing operating system, which I already have. So yes, in short, what I'm doing here is I'm creating a virtualization. That means suppose if I have a Windows operating system that is installed in my PC, I can have a particular virtual box and then I can go ahead and have another operating system that is running temporarily on my system, which performs particular applications. Now, this virtual box or this software or firmware or whatever I have with me is nothing but a hypervisor. That is something that brings in virtualization or eases the process of carrying out virtualization. So that is what a hypervisor is. It is nothing but a middleware or a layer that lets you replicate or virtualize your existing environment. Now, there are two types of it, which I just mentioned. We have our so-called type 1 hypervisor, which is your bare metal hypervisor. And then we also have something called as type 2 hypervisor, which is host OS hypervisor. Now, what happens here is when I talk about a bare metal hypervisor, it is something that runs directly on the hardware. Now, that is why it is called as bare metal. I have my hardware and I have a firmware or a hypervisor, which is integrated in my so-called architecture, which lets me create virtualization. And then I have something called as host OS hypervisor, which I just discussed. Suppose I have an operating system. On top of that, I would be having a hypervisor, which lets me have an emulated environment or another operating system running on it, on which I can run applications. Now, what are the advantages and disadvantages of having these two hypervisors? If I talk about type 2, it is a convenient approach when I'm talking about having a desktop level virtualization, because I do not have to put in too much thoughts. Just pick a particular software or a hypervisor, install it on my system, and then just virtualize an environment or have an operating system which I want to use or something like that. But this is not good from the longer run perspective. How? Well, there's certain disadvantages of it. Say, for example, I am a business or an organization where I have quite a few things to consider. If I just do go ahead and have an architecture and run a particular operating system on top of it, and in that case, if I try to have a hypervisor on top of it and run my applications on it, that would be very complicated. Why? If my architecture grows, then I might be forced to have a number of applications running on it. And this is where my performance get compromised. Plus, before building in that architecture, I need to have a particular operating system running on it. So I need to make a choice there and there. Instead, if I was able to have a type 1 type of virtualization or a hypervisor, in that case, I would not have to worry about having a particular operating system because it runs on bare metal. That means I just need a hardware which has integrated or inbuilt hypervisor in it. Now, in this architecture, I can pick the OS of my choice for virtualization and I can directly run my applications. So scaling up becomes easier and there are no performance issues. That is why if you take a look at quite a few readings that are there in the market or surveys that are there in the market, that suggests that type 1 hypervisor is something that is preferred more these days. And when you talk it from a business perspective, definitely it is something that is going to stay, and businesses that are going to be governed or run in future, those are going to be decided on the basis of what kind of hypervisor you use. And type 1 hypervisor would definitely give you an edge here. But if you talk about it from a personal perspective where your needs are basic, you can always go for a type 2 kind of a hypervisor. So yeah, let us move further now, since we've discussed so many topics as in what virtualization is, what hypervisor is. Let us go ahead and take a look at a particular demo that helps us have a particular level of virtualization. So what I'm going to do is I'm quickly going to switch into my desktop. I'm going to shut this presentation down and we are going to go ahead and take a look at a small demo. So yes, guys, what I've done is I've gone ahead and I've switched into my desktop. And what we are going to do today is we are going to go ahead and create a virtual machine or a virtual operating system to run on this particular device. Now, for this demo, I would be using type 2 kind of a hypervisor. Now, since we've discussed so many topics, I believe that you all are aware about what a type 2 hypervisor is and what we are doing exactly. That means I would be having a software which runs on my existing operating system. And on top of it, I'm going to create a virtual operating system that can help me run quite a few applications if I want to. Since we are discussing VMware here, so I would be using one of the type 2 softwares or type 2 hypervisors that is provided by VMware. And this is called as VMware Workstation 14 Player. Now, Workstation 14 is its version and VMware Workstation Player is its name. As you can see, it is for non-commercial purposes. That means you can go ahead and you can use it for your personal usage and all those things. And it works pretty fine. Now, having worked in this domain for a while, I have actually used quite a few virtualization tools and there are quite a few different ways of doing this. So this is something that is very basic and I don't think that you should be having any problem whatsoever. For people who are completely new here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and give you a link of this particular website where you can actually go ahead and download this software. So do not worry. In the comment section or the description section below, I would be sharing a link to download this thing. Just go to that link, click on a particular download option. It would be asking you for a version, as in do you want it for your 64-bit system or 32-bit system. Accordingly, you take a call on it and download your so-called hypervisor, which suits the need of your system. And once you do that, you can come back here and you can actually create a virtual machine. Again, since I'm creating a virtual machine or an operating system, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and create a virtual machine for an operating system that is Ubuntu. So in this case, I would be needing an ISO file which I can actually run on this so-called software. Now to do that, I would be needing that file as well. Now, I believe it is somewhere on 1 GB, that particular file. I would be sharing a link to that particular file as well. You can go ahead and download that file and this particular software and get it installed. Now, installation of this software isn't critical. You just have to hit on next and say finish and the job would be done. Once you follow these steps, this is what you would be having. And so let's move further and try to create a virtual machine or an operating system. So I click on this option. I say create. Now it gives me quite a few options. I would be selecting the last one. I will install the operating system later. The virtual machine would be created as a blank hard disk. Because this is a demo to a very basic level, I won't be getting into any complications. I would just come here and select this option. I would say next. There you go. Now what kind of operating system do I want? Ubuntu for 64-bit. And I say or select Linux. I get this option, which is the closest to me. You can choose other options as well, depending upon the ISO file that you've downloaded. And I say next. Virtual machine name should be, say, 5. And I say next. It would ask for a particular path. You can give that path if you want your virtual machine to reside somewhere else or this data to reside somewhere else. Apart from that, it would be asking me for my disk size. By default, it is 20 GB. We won't be using it for a larger scale or a bigger purpose. So you can actually go ahead and reduce it as well. That depends on you. You can even let it be default. Even that is fine. And it would ask me that, do you want to store it as a single file or do you want to have multiple files? I would say split the virtual disk into multiple files. And I would say next. And I would say finish. So there is this file which I have here. I would be coming here and I would be going to edit option. As you can see, these are the options. You can specify all the requirements as per your needs, as in what is the memory for this particular virtual machine? Do you want to increase it? I'm gonna let it be default. And these are the other details that you need to focus on. What is the recommended memory, guest OS, and all those things. Processors is one, your hard disk is so-and-so. If I click on it, it would ask me to select a particular file. I would come here and I would browse. Now to do that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and quickly switch into my VMware basically. I have this ISO file, I say open, and then I click on OK. Now I say play my virtual machine. I have to select my so-called language here and I have to use keypad here because normal mouse won't work, so I hit the enter button. And I say install Ubuntu. This might take a longer while. So meanwhile, I'm just gonna go ahead and pause the so-called session, and or I have Ubuntu installed, I would restart the session. I believe it is done already. It asks me to select a particular language. I would say English again, and I would say continue. Next. I say continue. Now it gives you a warning saying that erase the disk and install Lubuntu. Do not worry, it won't erase the data from your actual system. When it says erase disk, it is referring to the virtual disk. So for people who are afraid that if you do select this option and install it, it would erase all the data that is there on your system. No, that is not happening. It would erase only the data in your virtual space, which is already empty in this case. I say continue. Now I'm based in India and it gives me an option called as Kolkata, which is the closest thing I can be to. So I say continue. And it asks me for my details. So let's say Vishal, and I say demo. Demo and the password is say. There you go, I say continue. So yeah, this might take a longer while. So again, I'm gonna pause this video and then kind of get back to it when the copying and all these things happen. There are quite a few things which I need to actually reinstall. So it says install tools and all those things. I would instead say remind me later. So yeah, while I was gone, it tried installing some 135 files in total. So I skipped a couple of those. If you want, you can install all of those, but the installation might take a longer while because it tries to replicate a complete operating system. So yeah, these things do take a longer while. As you can see, it is still taking quite some time. And in that case, it might again take a longer while here too. If that is the case, I would just fast forward all this process and quickly switch to the end part or to the completion part. Now, what happens once everything here gets installed is, you have to go ahead and restart this particular machine so that it functions normally, or it just reboots once so that you can go ahead and use this particular operating system. I'm waiting for that option to kind of pop up. So there you go. The installation is complete now, and all we have to do is go ahead and restart this so-called application. You can just go ahead and enter, or hit the enter button rather, and your VMware would launch your VM or your operating system rather. Again, it might take a minute or two because it totally depends on the hardware you're using or the slower or the faster version it is exactly. Now, as you can see, there's this ID here, which I created an account from. I would just go ahead and log in. I'm not sure whether I remember the password. And there you go, I've successfully logged into my new application. Or there's some update information, I won't get into the details of it, I would just close it for now. So you have a blank operating system for your access here. As you can see, I've actually gone ahead and I've skipped a couple of installations or a couple of files that were to be installed. If you do go ahead and install those files, you'd be having everything here, browsers and all those things. You can even go ahead and download something like Picasa and edit your pics on this so-called virtual machine as well. But one thing you need to understand is, what kind of operating system or hardware are you using to support this kind of virtual machine? Because if you have a system that is short on all these resources, say for example, you have a system which has lower amount of RAM. Now in that case, your so-called virtual machine or operating system might not run as smoothly as you want it to run. So make sure that you take care of all these things as well. As far as this demo goes, this is where I would be resting today's session. In future sessions, I would be talking about quite a few other topics like what are the components of VMware, and then we'd be understanding VMware in depth. I hope you all have understood whatever I've talked about till this point. And if you still do have any queries, do put those questions or queries in the comment section below, and I would be more than happy to get back to you on those queries as well. So I would be resting my session here and here. Thank you. Bye-bye.
I hope you have enjoyed listening to this video. Please be kind enough to like it, and you can comment any of your doubts and queries, and we will reply them at the earliest. Do look out for more videos in our playlist and subscribe to EduReka channel to learn more. Happy learning!